Lord be with you. Good morning, everyone. It's good to gather and to worship together. With St. Patrick's Day later this week, we begin with a call to worship inspired by St. Patrick's breastplate. So we arise and come before God today, trusting in God's strength to direct us, God's might to uphold us, God's wisdom to guide us, God's eye to see before us, God's ear to hear us, God's word to speak to us, God's hand to guard us, God's way to go before us, God's shield to protect us, God's presence to secure us. May Christ ever be before us, behind us, in us, beneath us, above us, on our right and on our left. Salvation is in Christ. So let's stand with this in mind and turn to our red hymn books as we sing together our opening hymn, hymn number 59, New Every Morning. Let's stand to sing. So this morning, we'll be using morning prayer 2 in our worship. If we can turn in our green books of common prayer to page 101, page 37 if you're using the large print. Andy, can you just turn me down a wee tad, please? Both lapel mics, just a little bit. Thank you. Beloved in Christ, we come together to offer to Almighty God our worship and praise and thanksgiving, to confess our sins and to receive God's forgiveness, to hear his holy word proclaimed, to bring before him our needs and the needs of the world, and to pray that in the power of his Spirit we may serve him and know the greatness of his love. So let's take some time to confess our sins to God our Father as we sit to pray. We share a moment of silence where we invite God's Holy Spirit to search our hearts before we join together in the prayer of confession. Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault, by what we have done and by what we have failed to do. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand with me. O Lord, open our lips. O God, make speed to save us. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Praise the Lord. And as we remain standing, we turn back to our red hymn books to sing a form of the Cantate Domino, hymn 710. 710. Amen. Let's take our seats for our first Bible reading.
Our Old Testament Bible reading is from Nehemiah chapter 6 and verse 1 of chapter 7. When word came to Sanballat, Tobiah, Geshem the Arab, and the rest of our enemies that I had rebuilt the wall and not a gap was left in it, though up to that time I had not set the doors in the gates, Sanballat and Geshem sent me this message: "Come, let us meet together in one of the villages on the plain of Ono." But they were scheming to harm me, so I sent messengers to them with this reply: "I am carrying on a great project and cannot go down. Why should the work stop while I leave it and go down to you?" 4 times they sent me the same message, and each time I gave them the same answer. Then the 5th time, Sanballat sent his aide to me with the same message, and in his hand was an unsealed letter in which was written: "It is reported among the nations, and Geshem says it is true, that you and the Jews are plotting to revolt, and therefore you are building the wall. Moreover, according to these reports, you are about to become their king, and have even appointed prophets to make this proclamation about you in Jerusalem: there is a king in Judah. Now this report will get back to the king, so come, let us meet together." I sent him this reply: "Nothing like what you are saying is happening. You are just making it up out of your head." They were all trying to frighten us, thinking their hands will get too weak for the work and it will not be completed. But I prayed, "Now strengthen my hands." One day I went to the house of Shemaiah, son of Deliah, the son of Mehetabel, who was shut in at his home. He said, "Let us meet in the house of God, inside the temple, and let us close the temple doors, because men are coming to kill you. By night they are coming to kill you." But I said, "Should a man like me run away, or should someone like me go into the temple to save his life? I will not go." I realized that God had not sent him, but that he had prophesied against me because Tobiah and Sanballat had hired him. He had been hired to intimidate me so that I would commit a sin by doing this, and then they would give me a bad name to discredit me. Remember Tobiah and Sanballat, my God, because of what they have done. Remember also the prophet Nadiah and how she and the rest of the prophets have been trying to intimidate me." So the wall was completed on the 25th of Elul in 52 days. When all our enemies heard about this, all the surrounding nations were afraid and lost their self-confidence, because they realized that this work had been done with the help of our God. Also in those days, the nobles of Judah were sending many letters to Tobiah, and replies from Tobiah kept coming to them. For many in Judah were under oath to him, since he was the son-in-law to Shechaniah son of Ara, and his son Johanan had married the daughter of Meshulam son of Berechiah. Moreover, they kept reporting to me his good deeds, and then telling him what I said. And Tobiah sent letters to intimidate me. After the wall had been rebuilt, and I had set the doors in place, the gatekeepers, the musicians, and the Levites were appointed. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Sonia. Our psalm this morning is Psalm 27, Psalm 27. You'll find it on 619 of your prayer books, page 333 if you're using the large print. So Psalm 27, page 619, page 333 in the large print. And we'll speak out the psalm this morning by alternate verse. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom then shall I be afraid?" Though a host encamp against me, my heart shall not be afraid. And though there rise up war against me, yet will I put my trust in him. To behold the fair beauty of the Lord, and to seek his will in his temple. And now shall he lift up my head above my enemies round about me. Hear my voice, O Lord, when I call. Have mercy upon me and answer me. Hide not your face from me, nor cast your servant away in displeasure. Though my father and my mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Deliver me not into the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen up against me, and those who breathe out violence. Wait for the Lord. Be strong, and he shall comfort your heart. Wait patiently for the Lord. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Our New Testament Bible reading is from Paul's second epistle to Timothy, chapter 1, beginning at verse 3. I thank God, whom I serve as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience, as night and day I constantly remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. This is the word of the Lord. Delighted that Norman is going to come and speak to us now, so let's pray for him and pray for each other as we continue our reflections on Nehemiah. So Father, we pause and we ask for your Holy Spirit's help, the Holy Spirit who inspired the writing of the word that we've read. The Holy Spirit is here among us. Lord, would you take those words and make them come alive for us? Would you help us to apply them? Would you cause us to be more like the Christ we follow? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's hard watching the news at the minute. It's hard watching the television news, particularly night by night, hour by hour, in a sense. We're blasted with horrific, horrendous, hellish kind of images from Ukraine. See ordinary people, like those ordinary men and women, children, old and young, to see them being bombarded by all kinds of weaponry and munitions, to see them trying to flee and getting shot down sometimes and caught up in bomb blasts, to see all sorts of evil happening to ordinary people. That's the tragedy of it all. Ordinary people like you and me, ordinary families like ours, to see people like us subjected to such abuse, warfare, and to such difficult hardship conditions to live in. It's hard to take. It's hard to watch. And the thing is, you watch it, And then the next thing in the news comes up and your mind moves on. That's the way the television news is like, and that's the way we have to learn to live. But the news is horrific. It's horrible. It's awful. But looking at the book of Nehemiah over the last couple of months, if you take Ezra in since the start of the new year, really, in a sense, the books of Ezra and Nehemiah, but particularly Nehemiah, looking at that book in the Old Testament, that basically, I think, has much to say to us in a situation like we're in today about our mission, our purpose, our reason for being. But let me put it in the context of Old Testament history, because when you read Old Testament history, there's much that can be awful and difficult and hard and just hard to take all listening to those things happening to ordinary people like those in Old Testament history times. Particularly focused on the Jewish nation and the Jewish people, and particularly focused on Jerusalem, the Jewish city, the city of God, the Zion, to see the things that happened there. Because it's not 100 times removed, apart from the types of munitions that are used, it's not 100 times removed from the kind of tactics that were used. Here was a big, powerful empire, and you meet several big empires in the Old Testament history books. Big, powerful empire like the Assyrians under Sennacherib at one stage, like Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians, like Cyrus and Darius of the Persians, and like Artaxerxes, who's a guy that comes to the surface in our readings in Nehemiah. Powerful empires that thought they had the right to rule, and where people resisted the rule, the right to conquer. Where people resisted the rule, the right to destroy. And we've been looking at Nehemiah, that is a situation where the empire is the Persian Empire. The emperor has no real spiritual insights and understandings, but he wants Jerusalem rebuilt for his own purposes, for political purposes. Jerusalem is in ruins. And the ruins are not unlike what you see on your television screen at the minute, what we all see. Nebuchadnezzar had begun the ruination of Jerusalem. It continued over the next decades until it got to the stage where it was just a pile of rubble gathered in the highways and byways. When Nehemiah arrived there, if you can think back to the early chapters, he arrived on a mission where he was sent by King Artaxerxes for his own purposes. Artaxerxes wanted to reopen, if you like, the life of the Jewish people in the land of Israel. But his purpose was to send Nehemiah there to rebuild the city walls. But when Nehemiah got there, he tried to do a reconnoitre around the city, but he couldn't, because the city alleyways and byways and highways were all cluttered with rubbish. The rubble from the city walls, the rubble from the houses and the homes and the buildings inside. There was only a temple. They cleared a site, they built the temple, which was a good thing. But all around it was rubbish. All around it was bricks and mortar. Well, probably no mortar, but stuff to stick bricks together anyway. All around it was devastation. And it broke Nehemiah's heart. And it overwhelmed him almost with the task that was in front of him, the task of rebuilding the city walls. That's what he'd been tasked with. Tasked with by Artaxerxes, far, 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 far more important, tasked with by Almighty God. God raised up in Nehemiah a vision to see Jerusalem rebuilt, to see the walls reestablished. God raised it up in his heart. And Artaxerxes, under God's influence, I have no doubt, gave permission to Nehemiah to go with a purpose to Jerusalem, to go and rebuild out of the rubble, to go and reestablish Jerusalem as a city with a wall, a protection place for the Jewish people. Why Artaxerxes was doing that? There were political reasons, there were financial reasons. He had his own, if you like, his own purposes in it. But he lined up in that sense, because God was sovereign, he lined up in that sense with the plans of God for the city of Jerusalem. So he was the man who allowed it to happen. And in fact, he supported it happening. He gave letters to Nehemiah to say that the work can go on, and to Ezra before that. But he gave Nehemiah had a purpose and a plan and an action. He gave Artaxerxes gave the permission. Nehemiah went with a heart to do something about Jerusalem's walls. So we see the story unfold, and you've been looking at the story unfold. And as the story unfolds, as Nehemiah and the work begins, as it begins to spread around the city walls, opposition arises. Opposition from outside. Opposition led by a gruesome threesome, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem the Arab. When you read Old Testament history, there are three cartoon characters in a sense, but far more serious than that, three evil men with evil purposes, with plans to thwart God's work in Jerusalem. But they arise, and with them they arise, or try to arise, an opposition party from amongst their people outside Jerusalem and from some insiders in Jerusalem itself. So very soon after he starts the work, Nehemiah is confronted by opposition. But there's a purpose in God, from God in it all. God was doing a work in Nehemiah's heart at the same time as he was building the city walls. He was building something in Nehemiah to cope with what was happening all around. He was building something in Nehemiah to carry forward the work, even in the hard, difficult, almost impossible situations in which he found himself. And he was using the opposition to do that. He was teaching Nehemiah a lesson, a spiritual lesson with physical reasons, with physical outcomes. This week, at least over the last couple of weeks, as well as all the stuff from that horrible, awful, satanic stuff that's happening in Ukraine, as well as that on the news, there was a story of a ship that had sunk in 1914. Some of you know what we're talking about. The ship was called Endurance. The ship was an Arctic explorer ship, except it was in the Antarctic. The ship was commanded by Captain Ernest Shackleton. Some of you know the story. It's one of these big survival stories that's told throughout history. And here it's on the news again, because they just discovered where the ship was. Did you see it on television? The ship was at the bottom of the lake, at the bottom of the sea, it wasn't a lake, the bottom of the sea. And at the bottom of that sea, the ship was somewhat preserved when you look at the photographs. All the rigging and all the outside stuff is gone, all the top stuff is gone. But there's still a substantial part of the ship that survived all those years. But it's not about the survival of the ruins of the ship. That's an interesting reflection. It's about the stories of the men under Captain Ernest Shackleton. They set out from South Georgia, and they set out to, if you like, row and sail around Antarctica and get to the other side of the Antarctic landmass. But they get stuck in the middle. In fact, they weren't even in the middle. They get stuck in the ice. You know the story if you've listened to the news. The ice closed in on it. Once it got stuck, it couldn't move. It was trapped. And that meant the ice grew, and the pressure grew from the ice as the ice moved together against the sides of the ship, moving and crushing and breaking up. But it survived for a while before it finally went down. And even when it went down, there was still a substantial part of it intact. But it's the men who were the endurance. Who were the endurers, not the ship. The ship sunk, but they were the endurers, the men were. And Shackleton and his men set off eventually on a few attempts to reach the far side of Antarctica, a few attempts to get home. But eventually they got onto some lifeboats that they'd rescued and saved from the ship before it went down. And they rowed to a place called Elephant Island. And there they basically were into safety and security. Very few of them suffered death, but some of them suffered awful sicknesses. Dysentery was apparently something that was devastating them. Even seasickness had got to such a depth in some of their lives that they were suffering severely from seasickness. And somebody who commented, one of the officers commented that half the rest of the men were insane. They'd gone nuts, trapped in the island, trapped in the ice. But they survived, and they endured the hardships, and Shackleton led them to endure the hardships. hardships of endurance, enduring the hard days, the difficult times, the awful times, enduring the sicknesses and the weaknesses and the failings, enduring the hopelessness that would be theirs as well. They endured, these men. And endurance is something God's teaching Nehemiah when we come to the Bible story again. God's teaching Nehemiah the necessity of enduring, necessity of pressing on in the midst of all the troubles and difficulties and hardships, enduring the pressures of opposition, because that's where it came from for Nehemiah. It wasn't so much the ice in Nehemiah, not in Jerusalem, but it was the pressure of opposition from outside, with some from the inside joining in as well. The pressure of opposition was what he was called upon to endure. And it was doing a work in his life. God was working in Nehemiah to make him a stronger man, a more powerful man, through enduring the hardships. The ice closing in, the opposition closing in, but Nehemiah enduring some hard and difficult times in Jerusalem. Enduring times when the opposition, Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem, with their cronies, basically tried all sorts of different tactics. And it's interesting, as you read the book, you see they become more desperate as the work becomes more complete. And where we come to tonight, or today, in chapter 6 of Nehemiah, is where the walls are complete, the job's nearly done. They've just to hang the doors and the city gates. The job's nearly done. And you'll know very well that if somebody's got opposition arising against a particular plan and purpose of others, it's if the work goes on and the work gets near to completion, they get more desperate in their opposition. That's why we've got to be very careful, I think, and prayerful in the Ukraine situation. Putin, for all his madness, is still in control of things. But signs of panic and signs of fear and signs of sort of paranoia make opponents extremely dangerous people. Far more dangerous now is Putin than he was 3 weeks ago. Army people know that, you and I would know that. When the opposition begins to fear that the Nehemiah party is going to win, they get more and more crazy in their tactics. And that's what chapter 6 is about. It's worth reading through. It's not a difficult read through. You can just read over the big names. But here we see three ways in which the opposition sought to oppose this last minute finishing of the work, completion of the work of rebuilding the walls. They knew that if they didn't get it finished, if they didn't get the job done, their job of opposition done now, it'd be much harder once the city walls were up and the gates were closed, and the Jews could take control of their own protection. So they tried all sorts of different tactics. Not going into the details of them, but they tried the tactic of intrigue, inviting Nehemiah to come down to the plains of Ono and discuss things with them. They've been talking together for months. Discuss things with them. I think peace talks are always important and essential at times. But sometimes they can be manipulated and used by those that are clever tacticians, by intrigue and making allegations and making sort of it seem that the whole world is against Nehemiah. Intrigue, innuendo. When intrigue didn't stop him, he just didn't go. When they said come, he said no. Simple as that. He just stood strong and said no. Why on earth would I leave what I'm doing when we're nearly finished and go down to talk to you about things like this? Why on earth would I waste my time? There's a great project about to be completed here. Don't try and divert me from it. They tried innuendo. They tried public humiliation of Nehemiah, public accusation of him. They wrote their complaints, if you like, in an open letter. You know what an open letter is. It was sent not just to the reader, but it was sent to be read by everybody who got their hands on it. It's the social media of that day, in a sense. And the whole world soon knows what's going on. And the innuendo here was that Nehemiah is only interested in setting up a new kingdom. Nehemiah is only interested in a Jewish kingdom. Nehemiah is about to make himself, the writing to the emperor, about to proclaim himself king of the Jews. Nehemiah says, there's not a word of it. Not a word of it. And went on with the work. When innuendo didn't work, or when intrigue didn't work and innuendo didn't work, they tried intimidation. They actually threatened, or told him that his life was under threat. Shandoah, a prophet, not a prophet, in a godly prophet, but a guy with the name of being a prophet, said to Nehemiah, look, let's, you and I, find ourselves a place of safety because they're coming to kill you. They're actually out to plan, they have actually plans to come and kill you. Come and we'll hide in the temple and keep you safe. Tactic of making Nehemiah into someone who broke religious rules for the sake of his own skin. He wasn't allowed to take sanctuary in the temple. The temple of those days wasn't used for that purpose. So Nehemiah was subject to intrigue, was subject to innuendo, was subject to intimidation. But his answer to all those things was no. I'm not going to go with you. I'm not going to do it. Where did he find the strength to do that? Well, he learned endurance. But where did he learn endurance? He got the strength for it all. He got the endurance out of it all from working hand in hand with God. Every time a new set of opposition tactics came up, Nehemiah said a prayer. He prayed a prayer. I prayed, Lord, strengthen my hands. I prayed, Lord, give me courage and faith to stand. Don't let me give in to these people. So that's the way he stood. And others who stood with him also found that endurance and seen the job through to completion. Seen the city gates hung on the wall, on the walls. Seen the city secure. A city secure with walls and with doors, where others would have to fight them a fierce battle to find their way in, or before they just walked in, because the walls were all down. So Nehemiah learned endurance. Nehemiah emerged from this battle here. Nehemiah emerged from the spiritual warfare in which he was subjected. And he was found standing at the end, strong. Not macho strong. Sometimes you get the picture sometimes that what these guys are supermen. Samson type characters they all are. Nehemiah wasn't Superman. Nehemiah wasn't another Samson. Nehemiah was a civil servant. A civil servant with the task of being wine taster to the king. He had no training in these things. He had no warfare experience in this way. But God gave him the strength to endure. And through that endurance, God gave him the strength to overcome. And after 52 days, now think about that. Not quite 8 weeks, not just over 7 weeks. After 52 days, the job was finished. The job of rebuilding the walls was complete. The gates were hung in their places. After 52 days, how did that happen? Because God was in it. It was God's project. It wasn't Nehemiah's project. God was in it. God had called it all into existence. God had called the Jews to endure. It was God's work. And Nehemiah, depending upon God, throwing himself upon God time and time again, didn't rely on his own strength, but found strength in God. The task was Nehemiah's. The strength to do it was God's gift to Nehemiah. And he did it. And he rejoiced and celebrated in it. But the celebration comes not in 6 and 7, in chapter 6 and 7. It comes in chapter 8, so you'll have to wait a while for the celebration. But that's what happened. And the tactics changed now. The mission changed now. The whole purpose of Nehemiah and Ezra and others changed now, from rebuilding city walls to rebuilding the kingdom of God, to rebuilding Jerusalem and people in Jerusalem, because like the ruins of Ukraine, of the cities of Ukraine, it's uninhabitable in some places nowadays. Well, once the rubbish was cleared in Jerusalem, once the walls were built in Jerusalem, it was habitable again, but they needed to get the people in. They needed to get the Jewish people to come in and find security and safety. So that was the next task, part of rebuilding the kingdom of God, repopulating the city of Jerusalem. The whole worship life of the church of the Jerusalem was changed. The singers were put back in place. The Levites were given the jobs. People who were called porters were tasked with taking on their work and carrying things forward. That the city of God, that the city of Jerusalem would again be the city of God, would be Zion, where God is worshipped and adored and celebrated. And that's our task too. That's our task at all times, but particularly a task when a job is completed. To move on to the next task, the bigger one, of refurbishing the church, becoming rebuilding the kingdom of God. Refurbishing a church building, restoring the life and the spiritual life of the God's people in this place. The task is there, the task is every bit as demanding as the building of the walls. Nehemiah was up for it. Nehemiah seen it through, and God blessed him enormously. It's God's blessing be upon us. God's blessing upon us as his people, that we may be those who are endurers. We can find God's strength to cope with hardship, no matter what it is, and find God's will and purpose becoming our will and purpose as we rebuild the kingdom of God. Let's pray. Lord, praise you for the work of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem and for the miracle that happened as men and women work to you hand in hand with you. Lord, rebuild your kingdom amongst us. Rebuild your church, Lord. Give us a heart to worship, a heart to serve, a heart to share the good news of the gospel of Jesus with the people around us. Make us strong, Lord, for your purposes. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Norman. Our next hymn picks up that theme of finding our strength to endure in the Lord. We're going to stand and sing hymn 590, 590, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Let's stand together.
Thank you.
As we remain standing, we turn to our prayer books, page 112, page 48, if you're using the large print, and we declare together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us sit to pray. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord. O Lord, save the Queen. Let your ministers be clothed with righteousness. O Lord, save your people. Give peace in our time, O Lord. O God, make clean our hearts within us. A collect for this second Sunday in Lent. Almighty God, you show to those who are in error the light of your truth, that they may return to the way of righteousness. Grant to all those who are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion that they may reject those things that are contrary to their profession and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Will you join with me in the third collect at morning? Go before us, Lord, in all our doings, with your most gracious favor, and further us with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, attain everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In our intercessions this morning, we're going to use the following call and response. When I say, "The Lord is my light and my salvation," please respond, "Whom shall I fear?" The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Gracious God, as we approach you in prayer and we think about the world around us, we are so very aware of our own limitations. But we thank you that Christ Jesus and the Holy Spirit intercede for us in power. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? And so we pray today for the people of the world. Preserve the people of every nation from tyrants. Protect them in disaster and war and famine. And merciful God, as war rages and bombs fall and innocent lives are destroyed, we pray in particular for the people of Ukraine and for others who long for the day when they can live in safety and freedom. Prince of Peace, would you intervene? Would you beat swords into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Father, today we pray for our own country. Give wisdom to those who govern us. Keep safe those who protect us from danger and who form us as a nation. And this week, as we remember St. Patrick, we thank you that you raised him up to bring those who were wandering in darkness to the true light. Grant that walking in that light, we too in this day may point people to Jesus, the light of the world. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Father, we pray for our city, Belfast. Would you heal the rifts and the fear caused by violence and sectarianism, and also, as we've been remembering this week, institutional evil. Would you protect all of our city's children, especially the most vulnerable outside of families, and would you give them lives of hope and joy? We particularly pray for our schools and for our teachers. Would you bless our teachers as they seek to inspire our children? The Lord is my light and my salvation. We pray for our church across Ireland. Lord God, would you strengthen us? Would you rebuild us? Would you empower us by your Holy Spirit that we may be those who bring new life and hope to our communities? The Lord is my light and my salvation. Compassionate God, you bear the pain of the world. May we turn to you for help and healing instead of to the shallow comforts and superficial sources that the world tries to sell us. Would you be the rock to which we cling, strengthening and steadying us when we are at risk of falling? Would you open us daily to your presence, especially when we're distracted and you feel hard to find? In a moment of silence, let's pray for those who we know are feeling far from the Lord, those who are sick, those who are suffering, those who are struggling. Let's lift them to God in the silence. The Lord is my light and my salvation. And finally, we pray for those who grieve, remembering especially this morning the family of Norman Jackson. We pray for Colin and for Tracy and for their families. Lord, we also pray for those in our congregation who are missing loved ones, and particularly those who have the anniversary of their death at this time of year. Eternal God, I thank you that your love is stronger than death. I thank you that the Lord is our light and our salvation. Whom shall we fear? We pray all these things through Christ, with Christ, and in Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn is hymn number 97. Jesus Shall Reign, hymn 97. Let's stand and sing together.
Thank you.
Amen. Let's take our seats. Thank you, Brian. What a great hymn. Isaac Watts knows how to write them. A few wee notices before we go. This last week we were able to give on our way out to help some of the efforts in Ukraine, and that's through the Bishop's Appeal. And the Bishop's Appeal are giving the money to Christian Aid and to Habitat for Humanity, who are working with partners on the ground. So you know that the money is going directly to help those who are suffering as a result of this crisis. So today there's another and last opportunity to give to that. So on your way out, if you would like to give to that, then do so in the basket on the outside. And then we want to get that money as quickly as possible off to them. So please, today, last opportunity to do that. I hope you're making use of the little resource we gave out last week, the Live Lent Embracing Justice booklets. Do dip into those. I think they're great. They're very practical. And it's a good way of doing Lent this year. So please do use those. Also do dip into Bishop David's Lent Reflections recorded here at St. John's. The little 5-minute vignettes on the book of the Gospel of Luke. So you can see those every day through our Facebook page. Little 5-minute videos on the Gospel of Luke with a Lent flavor. Tuesday we have prayer club. You can come to the rectory and pray with us, or you can join by Zoom. Tuesday 8 to 8:30. Every Wednesday during Lent we're meeting in the Jeffers room next door for Holy Communion. So do come and join us for Holy Communion. Andy's Anglican Angle is one more session left. We've had two really enjoyable and informative sessions, and there's one more session, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, Wednesday the 23rd at 8 o'clock, when we'll be thinking about Anglican liturgy. So put that in your diary, Wednesday week, 8 o'clock. This Thursday and every Thursday, I'm looking for Tom, we're meeting, I think, as men. Is it on? Yeah? Is it back in Orangefield again? Great, sorry Tom, I missed you there. So men, Orangefield Presbyterian, 11 o'clock, if you just fancy getting together with other men, having a cup of tea and coffee and a bit of a chat, then this Thursday at 11 o'clock in Orangefield. Friday we have Tots Together, so if you've got wee ones in your family, do encourage them to come along to Tots Together with their parents or their carers. And if you would like to be part of the team, then do talk to us. We'd like to build that team up. And thank you to all of those who've responded and have got involved as that team. It's been great. This week is St. Patrick's Day, so on Thursday there are various things happening in and around Down Cathedral. But the main one is at 11:45, a service of worship in Down Cathedral. People from across the diocese getting together. If you'd like to join them, 11:45, Down Cathedral, this Thursday. On Friday the 25th, the band Harmonic Sounds are doing a concert here in the church in aid of Northern Ireland Children's Hospice, a great charity to give to. So that's March the 25th at 7:45. Come along. You've got the opportunity to have a great evening of music, but also to donate to a well worthwhile charity. That's March the 25th. A Friday at 7:45. And then finally, delighted that Prime Timers is also starting up again. So that's for our seniors, bit of fun, bit of fellowship. It's on March the 31st at 2 o'clock, and then every last Thursday in the month. So if you know someone who's in that senior category, if you think you are, and it's a flexible age thing, come along for a bit of crack on the last, yes, and the last Thursday in the month. And if you know others from outside the church who belong to other churches, we'd love to see them as well. It's been hard the last 2 years for seniors in particular. Let's get people back together in a safe way to enjoy a bit of fun together. So that's Prime Timers, Thursday the 31st. Could you stand with me, please? And so may the strength of God pilot us. May the power of God preserve us. May the wisdom of God instruct us. May the hand of God protect us. May the way of God direct us. May the shield of God defend us. May the host of God guard us against the snares of evil and the temptations of this world. And as we go from here, May the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those you love this day and always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.